to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Good morning, Kingsland. Let's stand to our feet, worship the Lord our Savior, sing praises to his name, glory to God forever.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, and now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God.
Beckons deeply a call to come and die by
marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way.
These kids were really bringing down the house during Bible school. They're being a little bashful this morning. But I want to thank Kingsland Baptist for hosting Vacation Bible School this week, because it was incredible. And we serve an awesome God with... We serve an awesome God. He has amazing powers. And we just saw God work in a mighty way this week. We expected about 80 children to top off our Bible school, and we, I think, had a total of 157. So, amazing. And we had over 40 workers for Bible school. So it takes an army just to put it on. And we saw over 20 children accept the Lord this week. So awesome. Just before the buses pulled out on Thursday night at 8:30, before the whole thing was over, I saw Mrs. Hamilton in a corner of the share hall praying with the little girl to accept the Lord. So that was just minutes before it was over. So that's just amazing, really amazing. We had people really poured their heart and soul into this week. And God just blessed it. It was truly a sacrifice of love, and God blesses that sacrifice. So I want to thank you all. Thank you all for making it possible. Now, we have our favorite song to sing, and I don't want anybody being bashful this time, okay? Especially you. I know you were holding back a little bit, okay? So let's really sing it.
All those that participated in VBS, all the workers, if you participated in VBS, you did sound, you did food, anything to help out with VBS. Let's stand and be recognized at this time, please. Let's give them a round of applause. And once again, it couldn't have been done without Wayne and Reagan Lowe putting so much work into this. Let's stand, let's continue. Our Lord and Savior, He is good. Blood that cleanses us and makes us whole.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood?
Empty claims I've heard.
because of the Father's heart to make a way for us. Now boldly we approach, not earthly confidence, it's only by your blood. What can wash away our sins? What can
us back in 2003. Do you remember Isabel? Does anybody remember Isabel? We lost power for like 2 weeks. Man, that was rough, wasn't it? I remember having our last meal. We were living in the parsonage at the time. Elizabeth and I had our last supper there. It was awesome. And then the lights went out, and it was bad for 2 weeks after that. And man, that storm, the biggest thing I remember about that storm is that that storm hit the exact same time that our baby was due to be born, but we had had our baby 2 months before that in North Carolina. So she was home with us with no power. And man, that was a lot of fun for 2 weeks with a newborn and no power. But that storm hit, and it impacted our lives. And of course, everybody thinks of Katrina back in 2005. When Katrina hit New Orleans, nearly 1,000 people died. It was an absolute catastrophe. And it changed a lot. It changed New Orleans probably forever. And of course, more recently, this is thunderstorm season. We just had them this weekend. A couple weeks ago, we had those storms. We were out of town for the storms, where many of you lost power for a period of time there. We were out of town for that. But coming back now, boy, the storms are hitting. This is thunderstorm season. And the text we're going to look at today in Acts chapter 27 should be very, you know, relevant to us, because the storms are coming, it seems like, every single day. And we'll read through this text bit by bit. I want to talk today about surviving life storms. And I hope that today will lift your spirits. I hope today will encourage you wherever you are in life, wherever you are spiritually, wherever you are as far as age goes, maybe in your job or lack thereof, or wishing you were in a different job. Or the storms of life come, and they force us to rely on God, or to curse God and die, or to run away from God, or to be angry at God. I mean, but really, when the storms of life come, they force us to rely on Him. We know that's what we need to do. And I am not an expert when it comes to storms. Some of you, we could have testimony after testimony after testimony of folks in our church who have recently been through extremely difficult circumstances. You're in a storm right now. It could be cancer. That's a storm. And this storm that Paul and his companions go through went on and on and on. It didn't come and blow out. It came and stayed. And they were stuck in it for a long time. It felt like forever. Have you ever been in a storm in your life, a difficult time that just seemed like it was going to last forever? Maybe a trauma. Maybe a trauma has come into your life, and it could have been years ago, that you look back and think, that storm nearly destroyed me, nearly destroyed my family. I don't even know how we made it through that one. Disease, debt, bankruptcy, work problems, failure, defeat, and of course the big one would be loss, losing someone who you love. Paul and his traveling companions in Acts chapter 27 are leaving Caesarea, and they're bound for Italy, which was going to be a long, grueling flight. Their eastward journey across the Mediterranean took them north over Cyprus, then south under Crete, and that's where everything went nuts. That's what we're going to read about today. Then they went north up into Rome. The book of Acts closes in chapter 27 and 28. Over the next couple Sundays, maybe 3 Sundays, we will finish this book, and it is an adventure. Anybody that thinks the Christian life is boring is crazy. The Christian life is full of adventure and full of storms and full of good times and some difficult times. And the ones we're going to read about today, some of you will be able to relate to. And what we see in the very first verse is that Paul makes a friend. He finds favor in the eyes of the centurion Julius. Let's just read the first 12 verses, and we'll go bit by bit to start with this morning. When it was decided that we were to sail to Italy, they handed over Paul and some of the other prisoners to a centurion named Julius of the Imperial Regiment. So when we had boarded a ship to Adramyttium, we put to sea, intending to sail to ports along the coast of the province of Asia. Aristarchus, a Macedonian of Thessalonica, was with us. The next day we put in at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and allowed him to go to his friends and to receive their care. That was a big deal, that he was that merciful and kind to Paul and his companions. We had put out to sea from there, and we sailed along the northern coast of Cyprus because the winds were against us. After sailing through the open sea off Cilicia in Pamphylia, we reached Myra in Lycia. There the centurion found an Alexandrian ship sailing for Italy and put us on board. Sailing slowly for many days, we came with difficulty as far as Cnidus. But since the wind did not allow us to approach it, we sailed along the south side of Crete off Salamone. With yet more difficulty, we sailed along the coast and came to a place called Fair Havens near Lycia. By now, much time had passed, and the voyage was already dangerous. Since the fast was already over, that's Passover, Paul gave this advice and told them, they know this time of year the seas are very dangerous. And Paul told them, men, I can see this voyage is headed toward damage and heavy loss, not only of cargo and of the ship, but also of our lives. But the centurion paid attention to the captain and the owner of the ship. That's the last time he'd do that. He listened to Paul after making this fatal mistake. Rather than what Paul had to say, he listened to them. Since the harbor was unsuitable to winter, and the majority decided to set sail from there, hoping somehow to reach Phoenix, a harbor in Crete, open to the southwest and northwest to winter there. Okay, so we see in verse 1 and 3, and later in the text, if you look all the way down at 42, we see that Julius had a good relationship with Paul. He was the Roman centurion on the ship who was in charge of the prisoners. He favored Paul. And it says we in verse 1 and verse 3. We did this, we did that. Who is we? Well, we is Paul. Luke is back with Paul. Luke and then and Aristarchus. They're in a ministry team. They're working together. Very rarely do you see in the Bible someone lone rangering for God. Very rarely. It's usually ministry teams. And then verse 10 and 11, Paul warns them about the danger, but they don't listen to him. He warns them about the danger. And of course, we read this and go, you should have listened to Paul. You could have saved your boat. A lot of bad stuff. But they didn't listen. Of course, in reading this, I think about all the things that Paul tells us that we don't listen to. Don't be drunk with wine. We're in his excess. But be filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul said that through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Do we listen to that? Don't be unequally yoked. They say that statistics tell us that many, many young people have no concern. Many Christian kids have no concern for marrying other believers. They're happy to marry people that aren't believers if they're good looking or sweet or nice or cool or if they get along. Paul said, don't do that. You're entering into a world of hurt. Fathers, bring your children up and disciple them. Admonish them. Do we listen to him? They didn't listen. It got him into a lot of trouble. And then in verse 12, I find this very interesting. The majority voted. And you see this over and over in Scripture. The majority voted wrong. The majority got it wrong. Sometimes the majority is wrong. Sometimes everybody going in a certain direction is exactly the direction you don't want to go in. Be careful about unanimous all the time, right? We have a business meeting tonight. Be here at 6:30. It's going to be cool. It's going to be great to see all the plans that the share hall committees put together for that building. You want to be here. But even we now need to be careful about the majority. When they do polls and the majority feels this way and the majority feels that way, is that more important than what the Word of God says? Absolutely not. Make sure our kids understand that. And sometimes storms come into life, into our lives, because we refuse to listen. Did you see the little thing that said, everything happens for a reason, and the reason is sometimes you make stupid decisions? everything happens for a reason. You'd think that was written in the Bible somewhere. Everything happens for a reason. Yeah, you made a bad decision. Half the time, the bad things that come into our lives are because we made bad decisions. They didn't listen, and they got into a world of hurt. Let's keep reading. Look at verse 13. When a gentle south wind sprang up, they thought they had achieved their purpose. They weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. Any of you sailors, any of you fishermen types, man, you're going to love this because there's all sorts of language in there for that. But long afterwards, a fierce wind called the Northeaster rushed down the island. Since the ship was caught and was unable to head into the wind, we gave way to it and were driven along. After running and wishing we'd listen to Paul at this point, okay? After running along the shelter of a little island called Cauda, we were barely able to get control of the skiff. After hoisting it up, they used ropes and tackle and girded the ship. Then, fearing we would run aground on Citrus, they lowered the drift anchor, and in this way they were driven along because we were being severely battered by the storm. They began to jettison the cargo the next day. On the third day, they threw the ship's gear overboard with their own hands. I'm assuming, you just got to think panic. Panic is setting in. For many days, neither sun nor stars appeared. The severe storm kept raging. Finally, all that we would be saved, all hope that we would be saved was disappearing. Now, verse 20 is a literal verse about a physical situation they were in. But those in our number that have experienced depression, when they use the terminology of clinical depression, this terminology neither the sun nor the stars. It's as if you can't even see, you don't even see the sun. You don't see any hope. All hope is gone because of the storm that's hovering around your life. Since many were going without food, Paul stood up among them and said, "You men should have followed my advice not to sail from Crete and sustain this damage and loss. I told you so." Verse 22, "Now I urge you take courage, because there will be no loss of any of our lives, but only of the ship. For this night an angel of God spoke to me." Apostle Paul, what a life he had. A lot of beatings, a lot of shipwrecks, but he got to meet angels, the angel of the Lord, Jesus. I mean, he had some really cool experiences. And he just says this, God sent an angel to talk to me last night. Wow, how cool is that? This night an angel of God that I belong to and serve stood by me, saying, "Don't be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar. And look, God has graciously given you all those who are sailing with you. Therefore, take courage, men, because I believe God that it will be just the way he has told me. However, we must run aground on a certain island. When the 14th night came, we were drifting in the Adriatic Sea. In the middle of the night, the sailors thought they were approaching land." Okay, so mid-passage here, Paul says, it's going to be okay. The angel spoke to me, and now they're probably listening to him a little bit more. We're going to make it. The ship's going to be destroyed, but we're going to make it. And I love this example of how God blesses those around us. When we serve him, when we live for him, and I look at the United States of America and Earth, the whole planet, as a wonderful example of, there are so many blessings. God blesses this world, and we as salt and light, the Christian world, those who love God, bring so many good things to our culture and so many good things to the world. And just imagine what it's going to be like when he raptures us out. What's going to happen on this planet when we meet the Lord in the air, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Imagine what it's going to be like on this planet when those who believe in truth, those who believe in justice, those who believe in God, those who believe in love are gone. Verse 28, "They took a sounding and found it to be 120 feet deep. When they'd sailed a little further and sounded again, they found it to be 90 feet deep. Then, fearing we might turn aground in some rocky place, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight to come. Some sailors tried to escape from the ship. They had let down the skiff into the sea, pretending that they were going to put out anchors from the bow. Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, 'Unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved.' Then the soldiers cut the ropes off holding the skiff and let it drop away. They are now believers in what this man has to say. When it was just about daylight, Paul urged them all to take food, saying, 'Today is the 14th day. You've been waiting and going without food, having eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take some food, for this has to do with your survival, since not a hair from you will be lost from the head of any of you.' After he said these things, they'd taken some bread. He gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when broken it, he began to eat. They became encouraged and took food themselves. In all, there were 276 of us on the ship. And having eaten food, they began to lighten the ship, throwing the grain overboard into the sea." Isn't it interesting that Paul expressed concern for their physical need there? He didn't have to do that. Of course, when you think they had not eaten in 14 days, just swimming from there to the shore, they may have not had any strength to do that. They did eat, and they did swim, and they all survived. And again, I'll just ask you, what storms are coming in your life? Health storms? Marriage storms? Divorce? Sick? Kids? Problems with your kids, your family? Conflict with a friend? A job issue? Money problems? Problems at church? Yeah, we have problems here sometimes. Death? What are the storms that have come into your life? And I would wonder, have you ever been stuck in a storm that you just didn't think would end? I mean, 14 days of this. Just imagine what that must have been like. Let's finish reading this. "When daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but sighted a bay with a beach. They planned to run the ship ashore if they could. After casting off anchors, they left them in the sea, at the same time loosening the ropes that held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and headed for the beach, but they struck a sandbar and ran the ship aground. The bow jammed fast and remained immovable, but the stern began to break up. with the pounding of the waves. The soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners so that no one could swim off and escape. Sounds a little brutal, but remember, every one of those soldiers would be guilty. Whatever that prisoner's sentence was, he would have to serve if he were to get away. But the centurion kept them from carrying out their plan because he wanted to save Paul. Just something that just occurred to me. Do you remember the night that Paul saved the life of the Philippian jailer? Isn't it amazing when you sow, you reap? In Paul's life, just a few years before, he had been the one who said, hey, everybody, stay. We're not going anywhere. The prisoners that you think would have been running out, they listened to Paul that night too. He saved the Philippian jailer's life. This time, the centurion is going to save his life. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard and to get to land. The rest were to follow, some on planks, some on debris from the ship. In this way, we all got safely to land. What a miracle. What an awesome example of God's grace in that story. And the adventure continues. We'll read the rest of this story next week. And within the next week or so, two, we'll be done. We will complete the book of Acts. Today, I want to encourage you. I want to try to encourage you. I hope that you will read that story and be encouraged by what you see. There are certain observations that I'd like to point out, just five quick observations that I'd like to point out from that story that should lift your spirits, that I would hope would bring a little bit of encouragement to your heart, because the truth is, many of us are going through storms. Now, some of us are going through good times. Things are great. Everything's going, man, that's great. We are very happy. I'm very happy for you. But some of us are going through storms. All of us are probably going to be going into storms. And we shouldn't be shocked. Is anybody shocked when the thunder starts cracking and lightning and all that in the middle of the summer? Of course not. We know the storms are coming. Well, life is that way, isn't it? Where problems come, and where we are sometimes prone to think, you know, is even God against me? No, he's not against you. He loves you. He cares about you. You're created in his image. Wants a relationship with you. There may be someone here today who does not yet have a relationship with Christ. And you're seeing all this stuff going on, the kids and their moves and the singing and me up here. And what's all this about? What's the angle? What's your angle? Here's our angle. We'll be very upfront with it. God loves you. We're here to help connect you with him. Nothing special about us. We're just sinners who've been saved by grace. You're here and you're either saved or you're not saved. You're either on your way to heaven or you're not on your way to heaven. But all of us are going to go through storms. And as you go through life storms, believe me, to have Jesus Christ living in your life, helping you through that, to know that heaven is your home, man, you're going to get through it. God is going to take care of you. And that's what you want, that's what you need, and you need to give your heart to Jesus today. I hope that the Holy Spirit will begin pounding on your heart right now. I hope that the Holy Spirit will get your attention and shake you and say, yes, I want that. I want what those 20 kids found this week at VBS. A relationship with Jesus Christ. There's nothing more important in the whole world. Now, when you have that, if you're taking notes on your bulletin there, number one, this should encourage you, and this is just not, let's just say we that know Jesus, we are highly favored. Have you ever heard that saying? Have you ever asked them how they're doing? They'll say, I'm blessed and highly favored. That's a great response. We are highly favored by God. In this text, we see that Julius favored Paul. Why would he do that? There was no reasonable explanation for that other than the Spirit of God working in Paul's life and moving in that situation. And we are favored by God, first of all, but he gives us favor with others. Don't let that confuse you. Some people are not going to favor you. Some people are going to think you're out of your mind for believing in God and Jesus and salvation and the Bible and creation and going to church and all this stuff. But God's favor is on your life, and he will give you favor with others. Remember what the angel said to Mary back in Luke? Mary, you are highly favored. Blessed are you among women. What is God's grace? What is God's grace? We sing that song, your grace is enough. Grace, G-R-A-C-E. What is God's riches at Christ's expense? The unmerited favor of God. That's what grace is. I didn't deserve it. You didn't deserve it. God just gives it to us. It's a gift. He loves us. It pleases God to bless us. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 2. This is the only time I'm going to ask you to turn today other than going back to our text. I really want you to see this. Do you remember in Romans, Paul told us in Romans 8, all things work together for good to those who love God? He said, we're more than conquerors. We are highly favored. We need to remember that. And here are some doctrinal texts that kind of undergirds this concept of being favored. Just like Paul was favored by God and Julius, so are we. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. It wasn't always that way. You guys were born as enemies of God. We're born with enmity between us and God. We are born fighting God and fighting to do things our own way. And it's not until we repent of that sin and turn to Him and receive salvation that we're made a friend of God. Are you there in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4? But God, who is abundant in mercy, because of His great love that He had for us, He made us alive with the Messiah, even though we were dead in trespasses. By grace you are saved. We were dead, folks. We were walking dead men before Jesus Christ came into our lives and made us spiritually alive. Now we're spiritually alive, but we're dying to ourselves. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. He also raised us up, verse 6, He also raised us up with Him and seated us with Him in the heavens in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages He might display the immeasurable riches of His grace in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. How awesome is that? It goes on to say, for by grace you are saved through faith, in that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works. Going back to the beginning, if you're one of the ones who need to receive the free gift of salvation, receive it today. Invite Christ into your life. Repent of your sins. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. And when you're born again, He makes you a son, a daughter of God. You are highly favored. Now let's go back to our text and move through this. Secondly, first of all, we're highly favored. Secondly, we all endure storms that challenge our faith. This text reminds us, if you've done any sailing, any boating, you've got stuck out on the Chesapeake or out on the James or somewhere where the rains come in quicker than you can get away from it. We all go through storms. If you, living in this life, especially during the summertime, we all have been stuck out driving in storms. We've all been there. All of us go through storms. You're not the only one. Sometimes when we deal with folks that have suffered loss, it becomes very internal, and folks can't get over it. And you got to understand, when you've lost so much, it hurts so much, and it's hard to look outward. You're looking inward so much. And sometimes the tendency is to think, it's just me. I'm the only one suffering here. Nobody cares, and I'm the only one. No, you're not. Don't swallow the devil's lie. You're not the only one. We all go through storms that challenge our faith. They appear to be unending. We feel helpless. We feel hopeless. We feel frustrated. May feel lost. My family's been through storms like that. I shudder to think, in preaching a message like this, I shake with fear to think about the storms that could be coming. I'm not hoping for storms. I'm not praying for storms. I just know they will come. I want to be prepared for them. I want to rely on Christ now. And I know that each storm that's come into my life has forced me to rely on Christ that much more. I remember in 1980, one of my earliest memories in life, I was 7. My grandmother and my grandfather died within a month of each other. My dad lost his mom and his dad in November and December of 1980. It was a horrible time for our family. And as a little boy, I remember walking around that funeral home. I can remember in my brain being there. And the storm, the cloud, the darkness, it just seemed to hover over our family. Then unbelievably, one of my dad's sister, Peggy, lost her son in a car accident 2 weeks later after that. And it was as a child, I can still remember how that felt. You just remember those times where it just seemed like everything was going the wrong way and things were happening, you were helpless and you're lost and you're... Listen, we will all go through storms. One reason we have the church is to encourage each other and to love each other and say, hey, I've been there too. How can I help you through the storm? You're suffering, I've suffered too. Let's go through it together. Third observation, we have co-travelers. We have co-travelers that go through the storms with us. They're enduring life storms just like we are. Have you ever noticed that girls travel in pairs? You ever notice? They're like cardinals. They all travel in pairs, right? And I'm not going to say any more about that, but it's true and you know it. Why? Well, they like companionship. They don't like doing things by themselves. I don't know. We all like companionship. None of us want to be alone. None of us like it. You know, Starsky had Hutch, right? Remember that? Cagney had Lacey. Yeah. There's a few mavericks out there, but most of the time, a team. We want to be in a team. Just knowing someone has your back means a lot, doesn't it? Just if it's just two of you. I thank God so much for giving me my wife. who's a companion in my children, my family, my church family. And Paul had his team there, Aristarchus and Luke and whoever else might have been in that little group. But this morning I want to encourage you with this. Even if you didn't have any of that, even if you do have all of that, man, that's great. Wife, kids, family, church family, that's huge. At the end of the day, if you have Jesus, you have enough. Isaiah 41:10, fear not, for I'm with you in the storm, on the boat, at home, in your job, at work, with your spouse, with a rebellious child, whatever it is, whatever storms, God says, I'm with you. He said that to Isaiah. I'm with you. Don't be dismayed. I'm your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand, right hand. And every single one of us have been in experiences, and I believe God designed it this way. I know in my life, especially the year before I met Elizabeth and fell in love with her, the year before that, it was just me. Yeah, I had friends. I had connections. I had college friends and church friends and all, but I felt so alone. It was just me, and I really believe the Lord gave me that year so I could empathize and relate to people. It's just you, and you feel like you're all alone. Just remember, you're not all alone. You're never alone. You have a Savior who favors you. All of us are going to go through storms, and He is going to be with you in the storm. Remember Jesus walking out on the water? Paul wasn't there for that. But I wonder if his companions were, and I don't know, in my creative imagination, I just think, man, Jesus, during that storm, he just said, peace be still. He can do that when He wants to. He waited 14 days of this nightmare to rescue these guys. It must have felt like an eternity, but at least they had each other to rely on. Observation number four, we serve a God who loves everyone. Please understand that about God. There is the holiness of God, there is the wrath of God, there is the love of God. These are not mutually exclusive characteristics of our God. His love is a holy love. His wrath is a loving wrath. We can't understand that. We serve a God who loves everyone so much that He sent His only Son to die on a cross to pay for our sins. He loves us so much that He provides us a warning about the impending danger. Think about that. Paul provided that warning. They would have saved the ship if they'd listened to him. They didn't. Think about the warnings He provides us. Think about that siren when it goes off. We grew up, my house was just around the corner, less than a quarter of a mile, to a nuclear, one of those big nuclear sirens, because we had a power plant right down the street. So we could hear that siren go off right before we evaporated. You know, there's no way you get away fast enough. But it would go off for other things. Sometimes it would go off for warnings. I'm so sick of the emergency broadcast system. And think, brr, 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 this is a test of the emergency. I'm like, what? I'm never going to listen to it when I need it because they keep testing the thing. Pastor Pete wrote a story in the Chester Village News about being in Alabama when the storms came. Anybody read that in the Chester Village News? When the storms came, Jim Davis was listening down there. And the sirens came off and people just walked around. They didn't pay attention to it, that storm was coming. And I don't know that it hit that specific place, but there were many places down there where it did hit. They didn't listen to the siren and people lost their lives. So today we have the opportunity to be like a siren blaring to the world. God loves you. He wants to save you, but He's not happy about your sin. And you can't have your sin and the Savior at the same time. You got to make your choice. And they're not always going to like that. They're not always going to appreciate us sharing that message. But God uses us to warn everyone about the approaching danger, including those who hate us, including those who mock us, including John Stewart, including Roseanne Barr, Rachel Maddow, and these liberal know-it-alls who mock us. How do I know that? I saw them do that this week. If that's where you get your news and information, God help you. You're getting deceived. I'm not trying to get political, but I'm just saying they think if you love Jesus and you believe this book, they think you're a nut. And they're going to do nothing but mock you and make fun of you. You need to turn that off. Get that out of your life and get it out of the life of your children. But we love them anyway. We love Bill Maher anyway. If he walked in the doors today, come on in, Bill. Have a seat. Listen to the truth right here. Listen to the warning of the judgment that's coming, folks. It's coming. It's our job to share that God's patience is long, but it's running out. And we need to stand up, and we need to lovingly tell people, even the people that don't like us. That's when it's really hard. It's so fun talking to people that do like you, and we all eat at Chick-fil-A, and we all get along. We're all buds. What about the people that are going to picket it? What about the people that think you're a bigot or a homophobe because you go there? What are you going to do with them? Love them. Reach out to them and stand for the truth. We must concern ourselves with the needs of those around us. And that's why we did Vacation Bible School this week. That's why we're going to do Operation Chesterfield here in a few weeks. That's why the youth are going to Miami next week. Pray for them. Because we love people. And we serve a God that loves everyone. Even the ones that spit in his face and pulled out his beard and hung him on a cross. He loved them. Lastly, number five, we will make it through the storms of life. I want to encourage you this morning. You're going to make it through the storms of life. Don't quit. Don't give up. Don't run. Don't get angry. Don't get mad. Don't get hurt. Don't be mad at God. I talked to someone in the ministry recently, said, I'm kind of angry at God right now. Couldn't believe he said that, but I said, don't be angry at God. It's not his fault. He loves you. He's going to pull you through the storm. Don't lose hope. Don't doubt. Just think about the way God turns things around. Did you see this Olympic guy from, I can't remember where he's from. He's a W amputee, Oscar Pistorius. He was born without his, is this the tibula or the fibula? Fibula, down here. He's born without him. So they amputate him as a boy, and they've reset him with prosthesis. This guy is running in the Olympics. He's already won in all the other the Olympics for folks with different limbs missing and so forth. But he's running in the Olympics. He made it. And just think about what that must have been like growing up without feet in the bottom half of your legs are going, who would have ever dreamed that someone like that could have made the Olympics? He made it. God brought him through that. I don't have any idea about his relationship with God, but I know that that is an example that God will carry us through things we didn't even believe we could make it through. He's going to carry you through. And as we close our service today, I want to do something a little bit different than normal. I want to ask you just to remain seated. And some of you will come forward today. I hope that some of our little ones who prayed to receive Christ will come forward and make a public profession of faith. If you gave your heart to Jesus, when we have our invitation, come forward and let everybody know, I gave my heart to Jesus and I want to be baptized. And we'll do that here in the next few weeks. Someone might need to get saved today. All this, God helping me, uplifting me, carrying me through, that does not apply to you until you've received the free gift of salvation, until you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. I'm going to pray with you in just a second and give you an opportunity to do that. Our musicians are not coming back. We have a song that I picked specifically for this day that I think will be very uplifting to you. If you know the words, just sing along with it. I think the words will be up on the screen maybe. Sing along with it if you know it. But today I'd like us to be in a spirit of prayer. And by the way, those of you that have come to the new members class that want to join, come forward. Or if you never come to any class but you want to join our church, come and request that. We'll have people ready to help you. Any children that come, anybody that's given their heart to Jesus that wants to come and request baptism, do that now during our invitation. 20 years ago, I lived in Maryland, but I worked in Virginia. And the only reason I ever came to Richmond was for King's Dominion. That's the only reason we ever came to Richmond. But 20 years ago, there was a concert in Richmond that me and my brother wanted to come to. And we brought a coworker. The three of us came down to the Richmond Convention Center, I think it was. And Stephen Curtis Chapman was giving a concert that night. And he's my favorite singer. Talk about someone who's been through some storms. That guy's been through some storms. Losing his little baby daughter a few years ago just breaks your heart. But that night, a new up-and-coming singer opened the night. Her name was Susan Ashton. And she sang a song called Grand Canyon. Sometimes you feel like God, there's a Grand Canyon between you and God. That's an awesome song. I remember that. But she also sings a song that we're going to play in just a second. It's called the Revelation Song that ministered to me, and I want it to minister to you. So as we come to our time of invitation, I want you to hear that song. I want you to pray. If you want to come and pray at the altar, feel free to do that. If you need someone to pray with you, come. We'll pray with you. If you need to get saved, ask Christ to come into your life. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. Make him your Lord and your Savior. Maybe it's been a while since you've been in church, and man, you really miss it. And I hope you feel at home here. I hope you feel comfortable here. We love you. We're glad you're here. We're here to help you. If you want to talk to somebody afterward, come talk to me afterward. Be glad to do that. If you want to talk to somebody about your spiritual condition, about heaven, come forward or come talk to us afterward. Just ask, bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to maintain a spirit of prayer over the next few minutes. You're invited to come forward. But I want this invitation to be for everybody, and everybody can't come forward. I mean, I guess you could, but it'd be kind of crowded. Where you are, or if you want to come find a spot at the altar, that's great. I want you to worship the one who loves you, who died for you, who lives in you. And especially if you're going through a storm in your life right now, if you want to lift hands and worship, you do that. If you want to stand and worship, feel free to do that. That's okay. You can kneel in the aisle if you want to. But I really want you to hear this song that says, "Holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come," and to know that He loves you. He's worthy of your worship, even when you're hurting, even when you're in the storm, even when things are difficult. He still loves you. And Lord God, I pray that you would move in our hearts and encourage us now. Lift us up. Help us to know that you're there for us and that you're worthy of our worship and praise no matter what. In Jesus' name we pray. Heads bowed and our eyes closed. If you feel led to come forward in prayer, make a decision, come do that now. Don't put it off. Come. Come as God leads you.
Holy, holy is He.
Would you pray with me? Lord God, help us to trust you. Lord, we thank you that you put us ahead of yourself and went through what you went through on the cross to save us. So we receive that. And we trust you completely. Even when things are hard, even when the storms come, we trust you. Help us to trust you more. As a church, help us to have faith to make those decisions and to try things and to do what you've called us to do. Lord, you have a God-sized plan for this church that could never, ever be accomplished in our own ingenuity or our own devices or bank accounts or talents. Lord, we need your Holy Spirit. We desire for your Holy Spirit to move mightily, to change us and fill us and guide us and direct us and to work in our lives, to save the lost in this community. We thank you for the ones that have been saved this week and today. Lord, we pray that you would bring those back who have wandered away, who have backslidden. Lord, may the storms of their lives just help them to rely on you and to come back to you. Lord, we pray for these young ones that know you now, that want to serve you, but they're young and they need someone to mentor them. Lord, help us to provide that level of discipleship that they need. Help us to be a place where anyone of any age, any background can come and be accepted and loved and taught the Word of God. Help us to be salt and light in this community. No matter how dark the world gets, Lord, help us to just continue to shine bright for you. And today, Lord, help us, especially these ones that would never even want to talk about it, but they're going through hard times, real hard times. Lord, I just pray that you'd wrap your loving arms around them and help them to know you're right there with them. They're going to get through this storm and that others in this place have gone through them. And they may not feel like it right now, but they are highly favored. They are more than conquerors. They are loved. We are loved. And Lord, we love you back. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In just a moment, Greg Edmonds is going to come and dismiss our service. He has a very, very quick announcement to make. Before we do that, we really want to take time to acknowledge these ones that have come forward today. And it's really cool. It's just cool what God's doing. And there's more that will come in the days ahead. But I'll start over here on the left. This is Jonathan. He's given his heart to Jesus, and he's come forward and requested baptism today. Jonathan. And little Abby gave her heart to Christ this week at VBS. She's requested baptism. And Amberly has also come forward today requesting baptism. She's given her heart to Christ a few years ago. On the last night of Vacation Bible School, I stood in front of a lot of adults, a lot of kids, but a lot of their parents, and said, "Jesus told his disciples, 'Do not prevent the children from coming unto me, for such is the kingdom of God.' It's faith like a child." Little children can get saved. Now, we want to make sure we help them, talk to them, assure them. We never, ever want to push children like into things they don't understand or whatever. But you know what? Their hearts are so open to God. They're so full of faith. And I'm just so proud of them. This is Maddie, Fens, Madeline, Fens has given her heart to Jesus, and she too has come and requested baptism today. And over here with Mrs. Harlow is Wade Bybee, who has given his heart to Jesus this week. He was born again, and today he's come and request baptism. We could just do this all day, couldn't we? We're not, I mean, this is awesome. This is fantastic. We're proud of you, Wade. And, you know, it takes a lot of courage to walk down that aisle. Some of us old folks are scared to death to ever do it. Man, you need to come up here and shake these kids' hands and hug their neck and let them know how proud you are of them. So before we leave, everybody just stand up here and let folks come and talk to them and congratulate them. And Diane has come to church today. She just prayed with Elizabeth to receive Jesus Christ as her Lord and her Savior. She's been born again, and she's requesting baptism. And so, Diane, we are very, very happy for what God is doing in your life. Did I miss anybody? All right, there's more of you that need to come. So next week, we'll be looking for you up here. Greg, get Chris's microphone and dismiss our service in prayer. Would you please?